So I have some bad news to pass along, and this happened Thursday evening, and I got a call Friday morning from Alan's camera, from Rob at Alan's camera, letting me know that Alan passed away the night before. I thought, well, he wouldn't be joking, but Rob usually would bust my balls from time to time when he would call. He's like, did you hear? And then he'd be like, we got the new lens or something. And so he's like, did you hear the bad news? And I was like, no. And he's like, Alan passed away at the store last night, which is unfortunate. Alan was 61 years old, and, you know, you went to the funeral with me.
I did.
You went to the service. Yeah. I went over to the cemetery after, and there were just hundreds upon hundreds upon hundreds of people that came out.
Yeah.
You know, it obviously sucks, because I wrote the story on Facebook where it said that I lost a friend and a mentor, and the reason, you know, I worked for Alan's, I think, maybe for a year or two. I don't even think it was 2 years. For some reason, I don't even know how long it was. But I learned a lot there. I learned a lot about business and how to treat people and how to buy better and just business stuff.
And I'm sure just camera gear in general.
Well, camera gear, you know, actually, no, I knew all that. The thing about Alan's is he just threw you to the wolves.
Yeah.
There was no training. It was just go do and learn along the way, which was hard because I almost didn't last the first week because I was like, I don't know how I'm going to do this. But, you know, I learned the simple things of learning how to buy better, understanding that if you pay your bill early because somebody gives you 2% off or 1% off, that means higher profits. It's as simple as that. If you have the cash, go ahead, prepay, or not prepay, but pay within the first 10 days if they're going to offer you a 2% discount, because you don't make a lot on certain items, and now you're making 2% more, which helps mitigate the cost of the credit card fees. And so all in all, it makes you more money, you know, and learning things like that, or when you're buying gear or you're getting stuff shipped in, to make sure you ask, what do I need to spend in order to get free shipping? So you're not spending $50, $60, $70, $100 on shipping. Or you're getting something in and it's like $20, $30. It adds up the more and more you do that. Just simple business things that I took away from there were really important. The other things are, it's just like Alan in work, you know, he had that really huge smile from work. Just, you know, everybody knows it, walked into the store. It depends on which day of the week you went in. But once 5 o'clock hit, generally, the joking Alan would come out and smile. And it was just a... You know, it's unfortunate. Yeah. It really sucks. The store's going to go on. Brandon will take it over. And that's, I mean, he's been there for 4 years. It was a shock, because you don't expect, it was like the least expected call that I would get. Yeah, it was the least expected call that I think anybody would get, is like, if you had a list of 100 people that you wouldn't put Alan on there as one that would have possibly have died at this point.
Mm-hmm. Way too early.
So, you know, I thank everybody for their condolences. They passed along to me as well as passed along to Alan's. You can go to the Facebook page. You can leave a message if you want to leave a message. It's just very unfortunate. But everything goes on.
Yeah.
And that's what it is. So that's it. We'll dedicate the show to Alan in this case, and probably many more shows to the future. Because the one thing I didn't say is, and I wrote this, was that Alan was one of the main people at the beginning who supported what I was doing with FroKnowsPhoto. Not sure that he maybe saw that it would have turned into what it had turned into, but he was able to help me get advertising money through different outlets that that he had, which helped support what I was doing early. So I had some money that I didn't have to either charge early on, or I didn't have to worry so much.
You basically kickstarted FroKnowsPhoto.
A little bit. Well, a little bit.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, a lot of stuff kickstarted it, but that really helped give a nice little cushion or padding to allow me to do certain things and invest where I needed to invest. And it was beneficial for me, and it was beneficial for him. So for that, I'm eternally grateful. And that's where we'll leave this part and move on. Sutter, I didn't get you a gift last week, but I got you a gift this week.
Oh, yeah?
It's an iWatch, an Apple Watch.
Oh, nice.
No, it's the band that the Apple Watch came with.
Oh, thanks.
It's the new hipster chic Apple Watch band thing that this watch came on.
Here, let me put it on and show it to the world.
Hold it up. There you go.
Wait, can you guys see me up there?
That's the new watch, man. I mean, that's the new hipster thing. So, like, hipsters be like, I don't need no stinking Apple Watch.
What were they called? Those like
snap bracelets.
Slap bracelets?
Slap bracelets.
Yeah, whatever they were called.
Somebody had them at NAB. Like.
You know those were made out of tape measures, right?
Were they really?
Yep.
They were awesome.
They were just tape measures wrapped in, because like they would wind up inside of the tape measure, but when you would straighten it out and smack it, it would want to rewind.
Well, that kind of makes sense. You ever slap your penis with it?
I will not confirm or deny that ever happened.
I'm pretty sure I might have tried doing that a long time ago. I may have tried doing that.
You may or may not have.
No, I may have done that.
No,
I don't
you
recall.
I probably did.
All right, let's start the show.
Let's do it.
Jared Polin, FroKnowsPhoto.com. Welcome to episode number 132. That is 132 episodes of this amazingly amazing podcasty, video podcasty, audio podcasty show. Now with 132 times more singing as of last week.
Yes.
Lots of singing. How you doing?
Doing good.
How was your week?
Lovely. So much more better with my Apple Watch once I finally got it all set
up. You made the real Apple Watch over here.
No, it was a busy week for us.
Yeah, it was busy.
Yeah.
There's always stuff going on.
We filmed a couple videos, edited. We had Alan's.
Yeah, we did Alan. We went to Alan's. Was that on
the service?
Tuesday?
Tuesday, yeah.
Yeah, we did that on Tuesday.
Mm-hmm. Monday we had our meeting. For the big trip coming up.
No, we did our meeting on Tuesday.
Oh, you're right. We did do it Tuesday.
We didn't do it Monday.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sutter, how was your week?
Pretty good. Hanging in there. A little busy, a little hectic, but it's nice.
What'd you do?
Planning some stuff. I mean, I don't know. I'm still ironing out the details, but planning my next trip and talking with a couple companies that are interested in sponsoring and such. But
yeah, what does that look like? Can you talk about it?
Yeah, I can talk about it. So I'm planning a road trip to Alaska in August, which is a long road trip. It's a long road trip. Time-wise, it's not much longer than my last one, but distance, it's almost double.
Wow.
But I have two companies that are interested. Mindshift Gear, which is like the think tank outdoor side. I just sent them an email, said, this is what I'm doing. And they asked for my address, and they shipped out a bag. It's coming sometime this week. And Polar Outdoor Stuff, they make tents and camping stuff. And same thing. I just said, hey, this is what I'm doing. If you're interested, sure. And they said, send us a wish list of what you want and what's your address. And they're shipping some stuff out for
me. Yeah, when it comes to gear, people want to send gear. When it comes to money, people don't want to send money.
Well, my idea of it is, I do this for them for trade. And if they like what I do and they get some return investment, next time I do something, I can contact them and say, this is what
I can burst your bubble on the Mindshift Gear aspect of it.
I'm looking more on the Polar end, for sure.
That, I don't know. Maybe they have money to spend. I know on the other side is that, generally speaking, they don't spend money for advertising.
Yeah.
On the other side.
I mean, that was a bag that I've wanted anyway. So
yeah,
you're obviously going to utilize it
and
for this
trip. And I'm definitely going to use it. So.
Shit, and they just got a plug right here.
Boom.
You're a dick.
Bam.
Now I got to go send a bill. No, I'm just kidding.
Cha-ching.
All right. I guess we should get into the show. We've got a discussion on photo news.
Yes, we do.
I think I'm going to be riled up this week.
Can't wait.
Gear of the week. Ooh. We got Weir of the Fro.
Weir.
And by the way, Steve Irwin's son's name
is Robert Irwin. Don't do it.
I saw a comment that said it sounded more South African than Australian.
Oi! I don't know what that sounded like. So before we do that and get into all the shenanigans and flying solo, because there are more flying solos, why don't we talk about our Atomos's stuff? I have bullet points from Atomos this week because they have a bunch of different things coming out. As we know, we saw that at NAB.
We
even covered a ton of it, but they wanted me to talk about the A7S and Shogun rebates, because they are giving you $500 back if you buy both, and you don't have to buy both at the same time or at the same place. So $500 rebate back on, that's when you get the Shogun. Nothing like saving $500 on any of that stuff either way.
Oh,
anyway.
Yeah.
$500 is $500. So if you need to shoot 4K and you're buying an A7S and you're buying a Shogun because you need the Shogun in order to save the 4K footage, you might as well take advantage of the $500 rebate that you get. Don't need to buy them at the same places either. But did we see the power station?
I didn't specifically see it at their booth, but their booth was massive at NAB, so
it was
could have been there.
You're probably distracted by boobs. But
the Atomos Ninja Girl.
The power station does seem like something that we could use, especially on trips, or even Sutter could use when he's out in the field. So
is that released yet?
It's coming out. No, it's available in a month.
Cool.
It says available in a month.
And that lets you do hot swappable batteries and
so it allows you to use the Sony batteries, the same batteries that we use for the Atomos.
Yeah, as
the
Atomos
is here, and we use for our FNV lights and things like that. So you can get, there's two versions. You can get for $295 and $395. $395 comes with the bigger batteries and extra plates for like a D810, a 5D Mark III, you know, because basically it's what we do with this center camera here. It's like an AC adapter. But what's cool is it has USBs on the side, so you could charge your phone also from it if you need to, or your iPad. It also has DC connection, so you could plug in and power other things that you need, lights and whatnot. But what I like about it is you have the two batteries there. Say we're out in the field and we want to record a 2-hour thing or a 3-hour thing. Well, with just the regular camera battery, it's not going to happen.
Yeah.
But with these two things right here, two batteries in there, it's going to be really good.
Oh, yeah.
That's going to work. And then the last thing, so I would check that out, especially for $295 or $395 for the extra thing. If you're out in the field a lot, especially doing wilderness things, it's going to be a great way to, because everybody has those batteries.
Yeah.
That's the weird thing.
It's like the universal battery now.
It's what everybody uses in the video world is that Sony battery. I think they listed it right here. The Sony NP-style batteries.
And they make the different renditions, like the big versions, the small versions.
Right. So that's what we use for so many. We have like 12 of them back there.
Yeah, we have a lot of them.
Because we use them in multiple things. Mm-hmm. And that's what's cool about them being universal across the board, that they're using those. So that's the power station. And then somebody was asking me, where can they get the bare bones? Because they couldn't find the bare bones. The bare bones, you can't find it because it wasn't available. It's available in June. Come June, you can get the bare bones offer on Shogun, Ninja Blade, and Ninja 2.
Oh, they offer on all of the recorders.
All of them. The reason that is they said if people already have a lot of batteries, you don't need to pay for the extra accessories. Mm-hmm. The other thing is it doesn't come with the dock, you know, the dock to transfer your stuff,
the
but they told me that's only $40.
Oh, that's it?
So if you just need that for the USB 3 transfer, that's $40. But the key here is for $395, you're going to get an Atomos Ninja 2, and it comes with the enclosure for the hard drive. Doesn't come with a hard drive, which it never does anyway, and it comes with an AC adapter. It just doesn't come with the batteries and all the other accessories.
I mean, really, that's all you need, though.
All you need to get started, especially if you're indoors or you're around here, is you get the AC adapter, comes with it. You get the housing for the hard drive, so you put a hard drive in there, whether it's a spinny hard drive for $99, or you spend a little bit more money and you get an SSD like we have, the 256s, then in that case, you're... that's all you need.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus, how many times have people said, oh, I want to record longer, but I can't afford X? So not only are you going to have a monitor that's 4.3 inches. Now, we know that if you want to step up to something like the Ninja Blade, the monitor's better on the Ninja Blade.
Yeah.
But if you just need to set it and
just need
forget
the recording,
it
yeah.
and just record, you can't go wrong for that $395 to do those. Well, it's not even just about the longer recording. It's about getting the footage straight off the sensor, non-compressed in the ProRes format that you want, and all of those things like that.
And they give you so much accessories and adapters in the initial casing when you buy a Shogun or a Blade or something like that.
Yeah.
So there's really, if you want to get a second one, all you really need is the bare bones package.
Yeah.
All
you really need. It's the all you really need special.
You're
from
gonna
Philadelphia.
Point that out every time I say it.
I point it out with it. All you need.
Yeah, that's what I say. All
you need is the Ninja bare bones. So that's that. So those are those things. You can find all the information on this stuff. Go to FroKnowsPhoto.com/RawTalk-132, and you can find more about the Ninja Bare Bones, Ninja A7. I'm kidding. I thought that would be funny if I was like, I forgot what I was going to say. A7S and the power station thing.
Oh. Hey!
What a catch by Sutter.
Solid catch.
He's like, accidental catch, because I never played basketball.
I played baseball.
Oh, did you play T-ball?
I played T-ball. I stopped somewhere around 5th grade. I don't know.
Jesus.
I played through elementary
school. So you didn't exactly play sports.
I wish baseball was a real game,
though. I played sports all through high school, just not baseball.
So this is done. We'll get to some other stuff. Why don't we get to some photo news, do a couple stories. We need to get to photo news music. From audioblocks.com/fro? No, audioblocks.com/go/fro is where we get all the music each and every week that we pick our photo news music. And what should it be this week? Should it be hipster chic, or should it be like wilderness traveling to Alaska? All right, here's photo
road trip
news
music
to the theme of wilderness traveling to Alaska.
Yeah.
Boom. Good music.
So good.
So great.
All right, let's get into that photo news.
Let's see. First up, we have a new series of clone portraits showcase a woman before and after losing weight. Photographer Blake Morrow was behind the project, which featured his friend Beth. The portraits were taken 2 years apart, where she lost 150 pounds in between.
Oh, back.
After she underwent gastric bypass surgery. He calls it the Beth Project. The photos feature old Beth interacting with new Beth, where she dressed up as 12 different characters in various scenarios. The photos are pretty funny, though, ranging from a singing duo to like her boxing her old self to her as like a corrections officer.
Orange is the new black.
Her old self in jail. It's good stuff. You can see the entire set over on the website, which
FroKnowsPhoto.com/RawTalk-132 So they actually took these photos first 2 years
from
ago.
From 2 years ago, yeah.
Well, that's cool. That's a long-term project
it's
idea.
It's a very long-term project.
Yeah, nice photos.
Yeah, lighting matches pretty well, too, for being 2 years apart, and everything looks really good. Moving into the cinema department, though, of photography, the first feature film to be recorded entirely on an iPhone is set to release this summer.
I am excited for this.
It's called Tangerine.
Tangerine.
I was waiting for it.
That's such a good song.
It is a good song. It's one of their only songs too, isn't it?
No. Dude,
are you talking about Vaseline?
Yeah. Vaseline. I don't need money.
I knew what you were talking
about. I don't need cars. All I need is... No, they have a Vaseline song too.
I thought Vaseline is the song.
Oh, right.
Isn't it?
Vaseline.
I don't know. It could be called something
Vaseline.
Now, director and creator
Tangerine.
Sean Baker used his iPhone 5 to film the full length, not even a 6 Plus or a 6 in general. He says one major benefit was that shooting in public didn't require the usual permit that filmmakers need to apply for.
Because he didn't look like a professional.
The film is set to have a limited release starting July 10th, and you can watch the trailer now over on the website.
No, pick me, pick me.
Hold on. The film was showcased at Sundance, and it got excellent reviews from the Times, so it should be pretty interesting.
You can only watch it on the iPhone.
That would be good.
It'd be like, it was shot on the iPhone. You can only watch it on the iPhone. Excuse me.
Mm-hmm. Did you see the trailer for it?
No.
It looks interesting.
Let me go over to FroKnowsPhoto.com/RawTalk-132 to see it.
It's about like a prostitute who finds out that her boyfriend's like cheating on her. And the whole movie, she's like trying
no,
to find.
Oh, no, you be cheating on me?
She's trying to like
who
beat her up and stuff.
Who you think you is? Y'all's be... cheating on me and shit.
Such a stereotype.
Yo, that shit's on Fleek. The fuck? Oh, that is the worst term in the history of terms. I heard somebody wrote that on Facebook. Like, I saw somebody, they're like...
What was it, a joking manner?
No.
It was serious.
It was this girl who said the protest was on Fleek.
Oh, God.
The Baltimore protest was on Fleek. Do us a favor. Post this on the website.
What?
The origins of On Fleek.
Oh, that video.
I've never heard that. I didn't want to bring this up about a month ago when Steven mentioned that this is a new thing that the kids are talking about. On Fleek. It means it's on point, I guess, but why couldn't you say on point? Can you run the? Are you allowed to run it here or are you not allowed to run it here?
I don't want to run it just to be safe.
All right.
Yeah, check it out.
But actually, you're allowed to under usage type things, but it's because we're talking about it right now, you can show it. It's weird, but don't do it. We'll put it on the site. It's just the dumbest term in the history of... But it's the funniest video. It's a six-second video. It's like a Vine. It's just this girl in a car... talking about her eyebrows.
Well, after I told you about it, you went home like that night and researched about it and sent me the link of the origin, you know, the original video.
And then Nicki Minaj Atois picked it up and put it in a
and
song.
And then it just blew up from there.
That's stupid term.
All the kids are talking
it
about it.
It better not take off.
It's already there.
Where? You hear people talking about
it? Oh, yeah. About it right now.
I mean, most of my friends say it as a joke, but I know a lot of people that say it seriously.
Yeah. Well, YOLO was a thing.
I say YOLO.
I mean, I use it more as
a
joke.
It's a joke, but yeah.
All right. Before you get into the next photo news story, I did do something in the store. I put up go get your strap on in my store right now.
Hey.
Get an iShoot Raw Black Rapid FroKnowsPhoto iShoot Raw strap in red for $15 off. Really? They are $64.99, I believe.
Yeah.
So discounted. It's like $6.99 shipping into the U.S. flat rate, and I think it's $14.99 or $15.99 for flat rate shipping around the world.
Have you ever dropped the price on that?
I did when I first launched it.
It's rare, though, right?
Yeah. I just want to... We got a bunch more in stock, so...
Cool.
I wanted to do that.
Very nice. Let's see. A new monobath developer called R3 lets you process your black and white film in a single chemical bath, hence the name. Now, instead of the normal chemical process, the single bath will develop, stop, and fix your black and white film. What?
How?
I don't know. It's chemicals. The developer was created by a company called New 55, who says it is the most convenient black and white developer they know.
Tell me how.
How did this not come out when film was like a thing? Wouldn't you think that would be like the objective?
But how's it going to... It's going to develop, and then it's going to turn into stop bath, and then it's going to turn into fixer. So it's like time activated?
I guess. Maybe. Maybe there's some sort of agent you add to the chemicals once you start the developing.
Yeah, you know what you add to it?
Does it?
Agent Dale Cooper's pee.
Now they say it can be used in the field, in the dark room, in your bathroom, or in a dark bag to conveniently develop your black and white negative film in a single pass.
That shit's on fleek!
Now, instead of processing your film with a normal three-bath system, the developer will work without any agitation, too, and will develop your film within 6 minutes of soaking. You then simply rinse for 5 minutes and dry it, and voila.
Wait. No agitation.
No agitation.
And 6 minutes.
And
now, it depends
minutes.
On the heat. So we know this from developing in black and white before. It depends on the heat, the speed of the film. I need to go read more on this thing.
Well, they also noted that you can easily pull and push monobaths with temperature. You just go to 90 degrees for a 1.5 stop increase.
Well, yeah, because the fat... But when you heat it up more, you introduce more grain because it develops quicker. That is one of those things. If you agitate too hard, it introduces
but
more grain.
But is that one of those things with this, though?
Because I don't know anything about this.
That's
is it
I'm
for
saying,
sale
so
right now?
Let me see.
Or is it a Kickstarter?
It's currently available in the U.S. in a 950-milliliter or 32-ounce plastic container for $20.
And how many roles can you get out of it?
They didn't release that information.
See, this is people don't realize what it takes to develop film. There was replenisher that you would replenish the chemicals.
The three bath system.
I'm gonna shut up right now.
Now the developer has been confirmed to work with these types of films so far. New 55's Atomic X film, Ilford Pan F HP 5 Plus, Kodak T Max, Tri X. And Shanghai 100.
However, you don't know about Shanghai 100?
However, they say it should work with any standard black and white film on the market, even old exposed black and white film that has been sitting for years. So, very interesting. I wonder how well it works. I'm sure Sutter's going to try that out one day.
I'm definitely interested, but I don't shoot a ton of black and white. But
yeah, I mean, I can
develop at home as easy as that says, I might pick up a couple roles and just go for it.
Yeah. You're going to break Jackson's heart.
A photographer named Jim Winters made his own shoulder rig for shooting photos of airplanes with his telephoto lens. His invention, called the Triaxes, is a shoulder-mounted triple-axis rig. The rig consists of an aluminum body that weighs 4 pounds, which it looks way heavier in the picture. It's basically
a cart. It's a
what's it called?
It's a dolly cart thing. What do you call them?
I forget what the actual term is for those.
A dolly?
Something like that.
No, it's the thing that you just... It has two wheels and it has a thing on the bottom. And you,
UPS guys use it
to
UPS, do all the packages.
A wheelbarrow?
No!
UPS guys
don't use a wheelbarrow. Anyway, it has a 12-volt battery for both counterweighting and the camera's power source. It has hand grips, shoulder pads, pretty much everything a normal rig has. Let me get to that. A remote to trigger the DSLR and adjustable mount that slides back and forth 6 inches, depending on what lens he's using. And like you said, a pair of wheels for easy transportation. That's how big it is that you need wheels for it. I mean, it looks like a bazooka. It's not the best thing to be pointing at an airplane, in my opinion. But there's a photo of him on the website using it. It's just this giant rig. He's got like an 800-millimeter lens and a D810 attached to it. And he just basically triggers it with the grip right here.
Not on fleek.
Not on fleek. I mean, hey, it works for him. It works for him, you know? Polish astrophotographer... This is going to be a tough one to pronounce.
Can I try? Spell it.
B-A-R-T-O-S-Z. That's his first name.
That's Barotz.
Last name, W-O-J-C-Z-Y-N-S-K-I.
That's Wojnicki.
Okay. He took an amazing NASA-like high-res image of the moon.
Which does look really cool.
It does look really cool, yeah. He used advanced image acquisition and processing techniques, mapping violet and infrared images of the moon to blue and red channels.
It did look awesome.
It did. The final shot was stacked together using 32,000 individual photos.
Oh! Which,
yeah. It's about 73.5 gigs of data. He took about 5 to 6 hours to complete this in post, and only about 28 minutes to shoot it, though.
That's awesome!
Yeah. He took the images with his monochrome camera, a couple of filters, his Skywatch HEQ5 mount, and his telescope, which is equivalent to a 2,350mm f10 camera lens. It's the Celestron C9.25 telescope. Now, he says so many shots were needed due to the instability of our atmosphere.
Atmosphere! Favorite Discovery Channel commercial ever.
I don't know which one you're talking
about. There were people that were like planets and they're hanging from ropes, making pretend they're in space. And the guy's like, atmosphere.
Now, due to the instability of our atmosphere.
Atmosphere.
Objects look slightly blurry and distorted when viewing from the ground. Now, in order to combat this, we have to take a lot of frames of the same area, which are then analyzed, stacked, and sharpened during post-processing. This makes the apparent distortions in the individual frames cancel each other out, resulting in a crisp, clean image. Also, as a bonus, we get a gigantic signal-to-noise ratio boost, which is great, which allows us to crank up the saturation and reveal very subtle color differences on the lunar surface. That's over my head. He says, thanks to the enhanced coloration, it's possible to examine the differences in the chemical composition of the lunar surface. For example, the bluish tint of several areas indicates a titanium-rich soil on the moon. A man got tased and arrested for flying a drone at the Hawaii Volcanoes National Park recently.
Dick.
The pilot, Travis Sanders, was with his family checking out a lava lake there.
Hi, I'm Travis Sanders, and I'm going to fly a thing over the lava lake.
Now,
No, don't tase me, bro. I'm just flying a drone.
When I first heard of this story, I assumed it was a normal-sized drone. It was actually a micro-drone, like the size of his palm, and he started to fly it over the lava lake. Now, a park ranger noticed and approached him.
I am a park ranger. Stop right meow.
Stop.
Stop it. Stop flying your micro drone.
Well, the worst part is he then began to run away as soon as the park ranger was like, stop.
Wait, and he's with his family?
And he's with his family,
what
yeah.
a dick. You leave your family standing there, Travis Parker?
It was them. Get him.
What was his name?
Travis Sanders.
Travis Sanders? What would Kentucky Fried Chicken do?
Now, the ranger shouted to stop several times, and he
stop.
Didn't.
Stop. Manalakalehu.
So he did get tased. Now, he did land the drone. He did land the drone prior to running, so he wasn't tased while he was still piloting the drone. He used the taser to ensure... Now, the ranger used the taser to ensure public safety only after he began to run. Supposedly, there was over 100 tourists around the same area. There's footage up on the website of the news piece that covered the story, which includes footage right after he was tased. Now,
yeah, what it, was it like this? It's on Fleek!
Jared's got his new favorite word.
Actually, it has his daughter like screaming in the background.
How old
She's
was
like
she?
A younger, I would
yeah,
say probably 3 or 4.
What are you running for? You say, thank you, officer. I won't do it again.
Well, that's why the guy tased him because he doesn't know what he's going to do next.
Maybe it's the B word. A micro B.
And remember, it is currently illegal to fly drones in all national parks across America
all
without a permit.
All national parks.
Yeah. So he got tased and the video...
Is it funny?
It's not funny. It's just he didn't look very comfortable, obviously.
But why was he running?
It makes no sense.
What are you
going
to leave your family behind?
There is
actually screw you guys.
And they did talk to him, do like a little mini phone interview in the news piece.
Yeah.
And he kind of gives his side of the story.
What was his side?
His side of the story was basically that he just didn't know he couldn't do it. He was just saying, I didn't know it was illegal.
Yeah.
Blah, blah.
So why'd you run?
That's the thing. Is why did you run?
Here's the thing. Freeze. Don't run.
Okay.
You said run.
Peace out.
And then you get shot. And then you blame the police officers.
Yeah. So, yeah. Not fun.
If you're not doing anything wrong, like you're flying a drone-y thing that you don't know you can't fly.
You simply just land and say, I didn't know.
You land and they go, and you go, oh, snap.
Slap
I will
on
put
the
it
wrist.
Away.
Yeah.
With a... I wish they had slap bracelets. Please put your hand out. We're going to give you a slap on the wrist.
That's one strike, sir. A restaurant in Tel Aviv called Katit and the Carmel Winery have teamed up for a new project called Foodography. The new project features specially designed plates that help foodies take high-quality images of your food with your smartphone.
Tel Aviv is nice.
One of the plates is a curved dish called the Limbo, which doubles as a plate and a backdrop. It features a slot for your phone, too, for a stabilized angle. Let's see. The second dish they offer is called the 360, which has a tripod-like stand for your phone on one side and a rotating dish in the middle, which allows you to capture 360-degree short video clips of your food. It's kind of like an arc spin for your food. They also offer LED lights for fill light while you're taking pictures or shooting video. And get this, a top food photographer is also invited to teach a food photography workshop while the guests eat.
Okay.
If you search Instagram for the hashtag... hashtag FDGR, you can see images from the project. It soon became actually a trending topic on Instagram right after their initial launch, too.
Nice job. Yeah.
Now, apparently this was a big success for them, marketing-wise at least. They invited a group of journalists to experience the project and ended up receiving $400,000 worth of free press, and the winery's sales also rose by 13%. I mean, we're also talking about them on here, too. That should be like $1 million right there.
Well, actually, let me call Israel.
Let me write this email real quick.
Siri, call Israel. Hello? Israel?
We just gave you some more press.
Menachem Begin? Is that you?
Now, price-wise, it costs $155 an hour for the experience and will be offered through June. However, they say there's a long waiting list. BuzzFeed reports that the winery is also planning to expand the concept to restaurants internationally. So it is a pretty cool concept, just a little pricey. What do you think about that?
You don't want to know.
He was like, this was all great, and then I heard the price.
No, it's just like, it's cool. It's great publicity. They did a great job with that. Eat your food.
Exactly. That is my
thought. Take a picture, eat your food. I don't have a problem you taking pictures of your food, but eat your food.
No, the best is when you're out there and you see that couple at the restaurant and they're just sitting there on their phones, like taking pictures of it, not talking to each other.
No, the best is when they're just sitting there texting and not even talking to each other. Yeah. And they're no, the worst is when you get the kid, all right? You got the parents and the brother, and then you got the one kid who's just on his iPad the whole time playing. It's like, Jimmy, put your iPad away and have a conversation. We didn't have this when we were kids.
I mean, we also had like Game Boys.
Yeah, but I didn't take. No, I didn't. No, I didn't have a Game Boy until Game Boy came out. We were already past the age of like 10. May have been 10 years old.
I was probably like, I don't know, 6 or 7.
But we didn't take games to the table when we went out to eat.
Yeah,
we had crayons. We would draw on shit. That's what we would do. You know, now, you kids need to be creative. Put the phone and iPads and iWatches, Apple Watches, and all your other bullshit away and have a conversation. And parents, don't think that the video game's going to raise your kids. I know. I don't have kids.
What if they're being creative on the iPad, like painting a picture or something like that?
Put the iPad away and grab some Crayola crayons.
But I can do it digitally on my iPad.
No.
Dad. A 26-year-old amateur photographer got his photo on the cover of Time magazine. Photographer Devin Allen was there for the initial Baltimore riots and protests and began to document it all on his Instagram account. Now, the image on the cover of Time features a protester running away from a pack of charging policemen. It's a pretty powerful picture. He says, when I shot that, I thought it was a good picture, so I uploaded from my camera to my phone. He says, by the time I'd done that, the police was all around me. I was in the middle of
it. By the time I'd done that, police was all around.
That's the quote. By the time I'd done that.
Okay, good.
I was in the middle of it. Now, it took several hours for Alan to realize the photograph had gone viral. He adds, I was still shooting, still snapping till the sun went down. He quickly gained 30,000 followers on his Instagram account, and his images were published by major media outlets around the world, one being the cover of Time magazine.
And yeah, he probably didn't get paid because...
Or gave him like...
That is true.
He put it on his following from ask.
It. Yeah, I mean, he got a following from it.
Is that a form of payment?
Well, it depends on what you do with it, always. But, you know, you post it publicly, they can pretty much do what they want. Just give you credit.
Can, yeah.
You know, credit Instagram, Devin, whatever his name is.
But can they print it on the cover?
Because
like
that's
that?
A financial gain.
Yeah, that's different.
I wouldn't say no if they were asking, so I'm sure.
And now he's up to 50,000 followers on Instagram, which is pretty huge. Time even wrote a whole behind-the-scenes blog piece about Devin telling his whole story. I'll link that on the website. There's also the actual cover you can check out, too.
Yep, it's nice.
So it looks like what he was doing. I, at first, thought it was just him taking pictures with his phone, but it does look like he was taking pictures with a camera, like a DSLR, uploading it to the phone via his Wi-Fi and the DSLR, and then posting it on Instagram.
Yeah.
And he's not cropping. It looks like they are regular 4x3 aspect ratio images.
Got it.
Leica has announced their new M monochrome type 246 camera, which is the world's first and only digital camera that captures black and white photos without any sort of image processing or filtering.
Yay! Yay! Go Leica! $9,000 to shoot black and white! Yay!
Actually, it is close to that price. The sensor lacks a color filter array, so there's no need for traditional algorithms that calculate the luminance values of each color. Leica says the result is 100% sharper images with brilliance and detail contrast that far exceeds what color photography can do.
... You will pay for it.
Yes, exactly. Main highlights include improvements in image quality as well as new video and live view features. Spec-wise, it has a 24-megapixel CMOS sensor with a max ISO of 25,000. They've also added HD video recording, a new live view function, focus peaking, and live view zoom. The new camera will be available later this month for $7,450, close to your $9,000 price
point. I'll take two, please.
And Leica is also planning to release new yellow, orange, and green filters for the camera in July of 2015.
Yippee skippy. Next.
Well, I'm surprised they added a video function to a black and white only camera.
Why are you going to add video?
To take black and white footage. I don't know. You never know. A new website called How Old Do I Look answers that question by guessing your age and gender based on a photo that you supply. Microsoft engineers created the website and say they initially made it to test out Microsoft's newly released face detection APIs and had sent out the invite to several hundred people for testing and feedback. Within hours, word spread and tens of thousands of people were visiting the site. Now, once you visit the site, you simply upload any photo. The site will analyze it, pick out all the faces in it, then label each face with a gender icon and with an estimated age.
Oh, so it could tell you that you're a woman?
Yes, it can.
But what if Jenner did it?
The results usually correct, but not 100% accurate all the time. And supposedly the two developers only were behind this project for like a day to put all this together. Now, I tried my picture and it said I was like 50. I think it, and I tried like three different images, and I'm like, what the hell? It's like 44, 52, 51. It's because these, when I smile, I get these wrinkles in my eyes.
You mean crow's feet?
Is that what they call them?
Yeah. Old women get them.
Thank you. And also said I was a woman. No. But yeah, it said I was up there in age.
Do you have the DJI story in there?
What's the DJI story?
That they got like $75 million in funding at a valuation of about $10 billion.
I did not, because we talked about that a couple weeks ago about them being evaluated for $1 billion, I believe.
Yeah, well, they got funding for they got another $75 million.
Bringing up to $10 billion,
and a $10 billion valued at $10 billion because I think they're moving more into industrial drones.
I saw that.
Something along those
it's
lines.
It's insane. It's crazy.
Insane in the membrane.
Annie Leibovitz recently stopped by the set of the upcoming Star Wars movie, The Force Awakens, for a series of behind-the-scenes photos for Vanity Fair.
Yeah, keep going, because I want to talk about this.
There's behind-the-scenes video of her shooting various actors.
There's not behind-the-scenes video. It's 24 seconds long, actually, and she takes like two pictures.
57 seconds
it's
long.
It's bullshit. You can't say that that's behind-the-scenes footage. Yeah, it's technically behind-the-scenes, but it's not a... She takes a picture of a Wookiee and a guy and a girl, and then the black guy. What's his character's name?
I have no idea.
I don't know his name either. It's not Lando. Maybe it's Lando's son.
I don't know. I watched the trailer, but I don't think they give
it's
out any
It's not
of this.
A behind the scenes. It's a behind the scenes it look, is. But it's not very good.
Technically,
why don't I just say
is.
That? Technically, yes.
But it's not very descriptive.
No, it's horrible.
Yeah.
It's horrible. It's not on Fleek.
But again, she was shooting various actors and character on set over on the, and that's posted on the website if you guys do want to check out the full behind the scenes epic
all
photo shoot.
All 58 seconds of it. Bullshit.
And you can see the final image they chose for the cover of Vanity Fair 2. Vanity Fair says its upcoming June issue will be full of never before published photos and details of the film from the shoot. So maybe you'll find out that guy's name. The full issue hits newsstands on May 12th.
Great.
And finally, a photographer wants to end discrimination against using expensive camera gear in public places. Photographer Jason Lanier posted a video showcasing his multiple encounters with law enforcement in San Francisco, where they questioned if he was shooting commercially without a proper permit since they saw his high-end gear. Generally, when we start setting up more than just a tripod and a camera, we get into the realm where we want people to have commercial permits, one of the rangers says in the video that you guys can watch over on the website, because anytime you conduct business and make money in a national park, you got to get a permit for it. He finished up with, the thing I would ask is just to make it less official looking of his photo shoot.
Now, Who said that?
The ranger said that when he was speaking to him. Now, the photographer says in the video's description, we hope this video sheds a little light on what photographers go through and why we hope we can do something to make it stop. So
I watched the video.
I did too.
Okay, and it really pissed me off. It didn't piss me off because the park rangers are doing their job and stopping and making sure that things are okay. It's the way that the guy presented the video. Either present the full video and then have your commentary, or don't present it at all. The way that he presents it is he plays like 12-second snippet and then puts some bullshit text on the screen about what he's trying to say that the guy is saying. No, the guy isn't saying that. And I'm not defending that we aren't quote-unquote, I don't think we're discriminated against. It's just the fact that people think that if you have gear that looks professional, that it means that you're always doing something where you're making money. We've had this happen to us. The first time we shot at a national park, we did at Independence Mall, which is where the Independence Hall is, and we to make a YouTube video, which, if you really want to think about it, technically is for commercial use, and we told them it's not for commercial, we're just out here shooting, testing out this gear, which isn't a problem. You can set up the tripod, that's perfectly fine. The only reason we didn't get into an argument with them at that time is because I didn't know whether I was right or wrong.
We weren't educated on it.
I wasn't educated, yeah. So they gave us information. They actually gave us false information that I then clarified with the park executive for Philly, and he told me that if it's for commercial use, you need to get permits,
which
and,
was
and
like
pay.
$25.
Well, it was $50 maybe for that.
Okay,
but you know it's $400 to rent out the pavilion.
Yeah,
which is not bad. Plus, actually, it was like $150 or $200 to rent the pavilion. But if it's not for commercial use, you're fine. So, I didn't like the way the guy presented the video. I also didn't like that he's down there. You know, he's off the beaten path in the water at the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco with a light stand and a model in the water.
And there's a model on standby, too.
Right. Though it may not be for commercial use,
it sure looks like it.
You're still going to put that on your website to promote what you're doing, even if it's a photo club. And let's say you're not doing that. Let's just say you're just taking sample photos and you're just playing around with gear and it's not for commercial use. You have a person in the water. You have your light stand in the water. What happens if she drowns? What happens if somebody gets hurt doing something? Somebody is liable for it. Do you sue the park and say that you fell on their rocks? Or do you have liability because you're a professional photographer and you have liability? That's what I'm looking at. And yeah, it sucks because every time you go into a concert or something or go to a baseball game, they're like, oh, well, the lens comes off of that camera. It's a professional camera.
Yeah.
And you're like, I'm just here taking pictures. There's no difference between me taking a picture and that person with an iPhone walking around. But you're never going to win that debate. The police, the first guy seemed from the video, because you don't know how it started. You know, the first guy in the car, the park ranger, the first time seemed to be on edge a little more.
Yeah, he was definitely.
But you don't know where it started
exactly.
Because you didn't see
the raw
video
uncut footage.
Like
yeah.
When I put up the video of my shirt going into the park and Six Flags, and they said you can't wear a shirt. I said I'm going to film you, and I prefaced the video when we talked about it, and then I ran the whole thing, whether I was a dick or not a dick. You got to make your own mind up, and then I can give my commentary. But don't make a video where you're putting words in other people's mouths, whether it's right or wrong. It doesn't matter. Let the video play, and then have commentary.
I get both sides of the story. I do understand the whole, you know, discrimination against high-end camera gear, that type of thing. And then I will say, with the rangers coming by and what they said, the fact that they still said, I need you guys to, like, take that camera flash off at least, or I need you to pack up no matter what, even though it technically wasn't a commercial shoot, I don't think that's fair.
No, you're right.
Yeah, I do.
I agree. No, yeah. I agree with that. And
what if you had just a smartphone walking around, but you were doing a commercial shoot? Would they ever stop you?
What? Because you can do that. You can have a smartphone and do a commercial shoot with it.
And they would never know.
And they'd never know.
They'd never know.
And that's just
so
the nature of it.
But like you said, the way he put the video together, it's a little more
I didn't like how he put
misleading.
The video together.
Yeah.
Now, here's how I would handle the situations and how I would continue to handle the situations. It's, officer, I'm out here shooting. I am out here doing the same thing that these people are doing. I may look more professional because of the way I carry myself or the gear that I have, but we are not doing anything wrong. And I know we're not doing anything wrong. The park rules, because you can read on the website, the National Park Services, you can read what you can and can't do. This is not for commercial use. I am not interfering with anybody. I'm not setting up in a place that interferes with people being able to walk or they could possibly get hurt. I'm just taking photos. I'm not getting paid. And I'm just doing this and that's it. It depends how much you really want to shoot.
Yeah.
But that you're not doing anything wrong. You can say, can I talk to a supervisor? But they just, you know, they need to make sure that the park is safe. I get that. But taking the flash off your camera versus, you know, but the guy is carrying an umbrella around. And yes, they were off the beaten path. And I don't think they were doing anything wrong. It just looks more commercial. But there is still somebody in the water and somebody and you're putting this light stand in the water. What do you want? What do you want them to do? You know, the guy came by and he's like, look, you can shoot. But you can't do this, and I'm being more fair than I think some of the other cops are going to be that come along
the
way.
Yeah, really cool he seemed, and like he said, you know, just put the flash away because I'm going to be a lot nicer than the other guy that comes after me.
Though it depends how long you want to have that debate.
I get both sides of the story.
You're in a national park.
Yeah,
and it's not.
You didn't give us the fist.
You want the fist? Yeah. I feel like it's also depends on what your park you're at, because a lot of the national parks I've been in, there's people shooting way more camera gear and way more quote unquote commercial looking stuff than I was. And, you know, I didn't see anyone stopping them. It seems like most people when they go to the national parks that everyone has a DSLR or some sort of camera. But yeah, I mean, I guess it's all on presentation.
In the Muir Woods, we set up and made videos. We didn't block anybody.
Yeah, but we simply just had a DSLR, and that's literally it.
Tripod.
Did we? Oh, we did have
we
a tripod.
We set it up on
You're
a
right.
tripod.
We did.
When you guys were there, I assume you saw other people carrying around cameras.
Oh, yeah.
Stuff.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Nobody stopped us from doing anything.
Yeah.
It all depends. I feel like if you're more in an urban area, you're going to have more of an issue than if you're like in the middle of, say, yeah, Muir Woods.
I say go to North Philly and try it.
I also didn't see many rangers in the Muir Woods, too. Yeah. Maybe in the beginning and the end, but that's really, really it.
Just the moral of the story is know what you can and can't do.
Be prepared.
And be prepared that it's going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
But if you are getting paid, technically you're going to lie to the guy and say you're not getting paid. Well, you are getting paid.
Yeah.
Like, that's their job, is to find people that aren't getting paid. Because the park needs money. They need money to sustain the freaking national parks. I'm not all for it, but it is what it is. And when you do find out that it doesn't cost that much money to shoot in the park, to go, you know, he was bringing light to the fact that, you know,
permits are too expensive.
The permits
right?
are too expensive. They just want your money to register. And they always tell us no. That's your experience. Don't put words in people's mouths. That's maybe not the experience that I'm going to have when I contact them. You know, you ask, I'm looking to do a photo shoot. He was saying that it's only for big commercial shoots. Are they going to actually give somebody things because they care? That's all they care about.
Yeah.
But no, if you just write up on the piece of paper, say exactly what you're doing, they still need to approve it. I'd get really pissed off if they say no and you're ready to go. But oh, well, that's it.
Yeah.
That's enough.
I think he was talking about the application fee, too. He kept bringing up on top of that.
Yeah. I get it.
Yeah.
I get it, but I didn't like his video.
Mm-hmm. And that's it for Photo News. A lot of stories, but yeah, figured I ended on that one.
Whatever. Is the show over yet?
Are you going to do your post-news music?
Yeah, let's do some pissed off post news music. Let's do some cops, like Bad Boys, Bad Boys.
Hey,
what
if
there's
no Bad Boys?
We're gonna come up with something related to cops.
All right,
and getting in trouble.
Cop related.
Here we go. Rolling out of Photo News. All right, what time is it?
Flying solo time?
Or
question
yeah.
mark? It is your turn to do
flying
solo.
I have questions. All I did on Facebook is I said, let them roll or something.
You didn't say, let's beat the comments from last week.
No, I just said, let's get comments, go.
Yeah.
You know, and that was it.
That's cool.
Because what do we have? We've got photo news done.
Check.
We played the music.
Cross
Gear
out.
Of the week coming up. Wheel of Fro-Knows Photo, that's me, coming up.
That is you.
And now we've got to fly solo.
What's that guy with the fro?
I had no idea.
Jason Pollack. appalling. Hey, I forgot to ask people to do their phonetic spelling.
Oh, yeah. Well, you brought it up last week. Hopefully they maybe did it this
nobody
time.
Nobody did. So nobody listens to the show.
No one watches.
Nobody listens to the show.
That's great.
We just make it for my neighbor.
There you go. I actually just click on YouTube, refresh, and keep resetting
you do
my
that
cookies
too?
Every time. That's why we get all the views.
Jason Pollack. This one is for Eckert.
Hey.
When you leave after finishing, he usually sends me his heartbeat.
Last night I sent you the heartbeat.
Yeah, why did you? I'm like, your heart is racing so fast, Steven. Why?
I don't know.
Did your girlfriend just leave?
Maybe.
After finishing a RAWtalk episode, do you ever think to yourself, holy shit, quote unquote, Jared really sucks at singing? You know, being in the radio business and all.
I think that every single episode.
My singing is on fleek.
You're lucky I add all the reverb and nice tone on
Mike
it every
Hall,
time.
Mike Hall, a few days... What, Sutter? You
I
didn't raise your
you
hand.
I said you should start auto-tuning.
I do
on occasion.
Auto-tune
like
me.
T-Pain.
On occasion. Sometimes I don't.
Mike Hall.
Because it's so good.
A few days ago, I had one of the four major TV networks email me asking for permission to license one of my photos, my photo tweets in a documentary series on viral weather-related photos. I replied informing them that I would be willing to license the image to them. Too many thems. I asked if they had a standard fee to pay for licensing an image, which is a good question to ask. The next day, I get a reply stating that they usually secure a license to use an image for free since they had a low budget. Earmuffs. Fuck you. If I had a number in mind, however, they would run it by their producer. I did a little research and shot them a number a little below stock price for a similar image, in this case $200, being the first time I've attempted to license an image. I didn't want to overvalue my work, but I refused to undervalue it. I haven't heard back, and I don't expect to. Do you think there is anything I could have done differently to help make the sale, or was I fighting a lost cause in this case? Now, this is something that a lot of people are going to face quite often.
Wow, that's a big question.
I read it because it was legitimate.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I hope that your questions aren't this long always. You know, $200 for them to use it in a video that they're going to make money off of by selling ads against, you know, we have a low budget. Okay, you have a low budget, then good luck. Go have somebody else's photo. You know, that's the decision you have to make. Is it worth something to have your photo in there, or is it not? I don't think you did anything wrong by asking for $200. You did your research, you found what stock images are going for, and you made it a little less than stock images, but you didn't make it so out of reality that they would have just been like, no way in hell. You made it reasonable.
Yeah, and very reasonable.
They have a low budget, so what? That's not your problem. I mean, it is your problem because then, this is the problem you face in a lot of business that we do today, is I have no budget for that. I'm only producing a book for a band that toured 15 years ago and has a lot of money, or I can't say they have a lot of money, but I will say they're producing a book to sell. And just having my name in it doesn't mean shit.
We want everything, but we have no budget at all to make it.
Well, I'm sorry. That's not going to work. It's not going to cut it. I don't think you did anything wrong. You just say, oh, well, it's not on fleek. Let's move on. Athol Nakarami. Do you think that knowing video is starting to become a requirement for success in photography? I'm getting more requests for video than I am photos these days. Do you think that soon we will all be shooting video and just pulling high-resolution stills from the video? This is a good question.
It is a good question.
If you think that you don't need to know video because you're just a quote-unquote photographer, you're going to be left in the dust. You're just going to be left in the dust. Everybody is shooting video and learning how to do it. It's because it gives you another opportunity to add more money to your bottom line.
Yeah.
Why not offer shooting video and stills and padding your bottom line. And if you don't know what you're doing, check out the FroKnowsPhoto guide to DSLR video. Go purchase that. It's $97. It's 6 hours of content. Not only is it going to help you become a better person for shooting video and making more money, you're also supporting the site at the same time. That thing should be charged. We should be charging a hell of a lot more than $97 for what that video guide, if you watch it, is going to make you, because it's going to give you the ability today to take your camera, turn it into video mode, and go out and know what you're doing. If you just take, there are so many nuggets of information throughout that damn guide that you're going to watch it multiple times. It's going to help you. It gives you that kick in the ass that I didn't have, because when I started shooting video, I sucked and didn't know what I was doing wrong. This gives you a starting point to give you the ability to start and then figure out the rest of the way once you have the basics down, the fundamentals. Go buy that. I think it is extremely important. I don't think we're going to get to the place yet where you're pulling still straight from the video, but it's not going to be far off into the future. But that doesn't mean that that's going to be how we're going to do it. A lot of people shoot already photos like they're shooting a film because they're just motor driving and ending up with just so many shitty pictures. So I don't think it's going to get there, but I don't think that's going to kill photography.
Well, I think one of the big things that really hasn't caught up to video just yet is weddings. People do get a videographer with their package typically, but I still think they spend a majority of their budget on the still photographer, and they kind of spend, you know, like a fraction of that on the videographer just to capture the entire thing, not a huge production. Granted, there is plenty of people that still do a big production and spend more on a videographer, but I still think they focus more on the still aspect.
Got it.
Yeah. But you know, I think it's getting there to change. You know, it's starting to change in that part.
Change is going to come.
Change is going to come, yeah.
I can't sing that song from Selma.
I just watched that last night.
Was it good?
It was really good.
It was a good
really
movie?
Really powerful movie, yeah.
Change is going to come. John Legend.
The actor who played Martin Luther.
King Jr.
Martin Luther King Jr., yeah. Great actor.
Who was it?
I don't know his name. That's why I said the actor. I would say his name if I remembered, but...
What's the code for photo book still?
PXFRO35MD.
Yes, this will still be available until May 16th.
Yep, you'll have a couple days when this gets released.
PXFRO35MD. A lot of people have already used the code because you're getting 35% off Adoramapix photo books. I got a code from them to give to you so that you can use it. A lot of the books, I want to see your results, so please tweet them to me or put them on Facebook. I want to see the books that you're getting. A lot of people are loving the quality of the books that they're getting.
I think
that's where
cool
I'll leave it.
To do like almost like a flip through reveal type of video, even if it's with your smartphone.
Oh yeah,
or
anytime
you know?
Get a photo book maker, it's what I do with the pizza book.
Yeah,
and I have
not?
Another one of those to go up soon, but that is that.
Cool.
Did I read this question yet?
Which one?
No. Patrick Hawkins. If you shoot a wedding and the couple separates before pictures are even delivered, what do you do with the pictures? Should you reliver them?
Reliver them?
Deliver them, I think it's supposed to be. That's supposed to be a D. Could you use them for your website? Well, they already signed a contract. So this has happened before,
but
not
who do
to
you
me.
Give it to?
This has happened to me before, mm-hmm. not to me. Hasn't happened to me. Happened to a guy I shot his second wedding.
Happened to a friend of mine.
His first wedding. There was issues before they even got delivered the book, and I think they just told the photographer to keep it.
Wow.
What are you going to do?
Yeah.
If you don't want
the
photos.
I'm sure that's
the
last thing you
want
to look at.
You don't want the photos.
When you're going through a divorce.
It is what it is. You try to, you call them both. Or you call whoever you have and you say, I have the photos. You try to, you hold on to them. You never get rid of them in case they want them. You make document that you tried to deliver them and they didn't want it.
Or what if you get back together?
Right. So that's just one of those things.
I think I'd want it more for just the family pictures, though, of my, you know, family.
Tico Ooms. One for Steven Eckert.
Hey.
How do you set the audio levels on an external audio recorder like the Zoom? Where do you want the gain to be, high or low? And how to account for peaks? Low-pass filter on, even when the gain is high, so peaks are more likely to happen? Spelled out question mark.
I mean, it totally depends what type of environment you're on for the low pass filter. In here, I usually have it on because you have your air conditioning running, your fridge. You usually have just everything on to
my faucet's dripping water.
Your faucet's dripping, any of that low end background noise. So I typically have that on in this environment. But if you're in a clean studio, I would keep it off. As far as setting my levels, I typically will set them -6 to -12 dB to give it that leeway to peak. It is okay to peak on occasion if Jared's screaming or something. I
back away from the microphone.
Yeah, but he does have mic etiquette, so he is pretty good on it.
I'm really good on microphones.
You actually really are, because when I look in, there's no compression. I keep it flat in the Zoom recorder that we use. And when I bring it up in Adobe Audition, your levels are nearly straight the entire time.
Because I know how far I can get away from the microphone now.
Pretty good.
Because we're on episode 132.
Yeah. But you've never seen behind the scenes of me editing.
No.
So you don't know what that WAV file looks like, and you've done a good job.
I'm really good at mic etiquette. I know when I get loud, I can back away.
But it really depends gain level, like what what microphones you're using, what type of input. Typically for this, I have it on 3 to 4 on the Zoom recorder. It all depends what recorder you're using. Testing the gain is really just
It's just somebody speaking.
Speak normal, get high, get low, set your level in between, and there you go.
You want to get high?
But it's that easy. I mean,
you
it's
guys
really
wanna get
it's
not high?
Too low pass filter though. If you're unsure of that, turn it on. If it gives you the frequency range, turn on a very low frequency.
Brian Zalewski, when you first started out, was everyone supportive of your decision in photography and then YouTube, or were those close to you, i.e. friends, family, think you should be doing something different? And you had to prove it to them by showing them. In my case, I went a complete different direction. I was going and am now on this path. I don't know what the hell that means. I'm not receiving support from close family. They don't see it as a job. Well, screw them. I mean, look.
It's that working from home type
right.
Profession.
Right. I mean, my dad didn't understand what the hell I was doing every day.
Yeah.
But he also knew that there was no other alternative because this is what I was going to do, photography in one fashion or another, something creative. And my parents always told us that you do what you want to do. We will support that in any way possible. If we need to get you teachers or you need to get training, we will help, because you know, when they were growing up and my mom was told she couldn't do certain things because of her size, or my dad was told that he had to be a doctor and he rebelled and didn't, that's not what he wanted. He wanted to be a sportscaster. They knew that they weren't going to tell us what we had to do. They were going to be supportive of the choices that we made. You can't worry about what the other people, what your friends and family. It's like I went out with this girl one time, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I told you this story. And she goes, I don't think I can take you home to my family and friends because your hair.
Oh,
they
yeah.
just won't get it.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, that is the absolute dumbest thing I've ever heard. You either like me or you don't like me. If you're going to say that it's because of my hair and you don't want to take me home because of my hair, then go pound sand.
Can't judge a book by its cover, right?
But she knew me.
Yeah.
So anyway, I was like,
no, I'm
we're
saying
done.
Her family.
No, I'm like, we're done. Bye. Yeah. Later. See ya. Adios.
It is a shame, though, with his family not getting it.
It is a shame. But you do what you do.
You got to just do it. Yeah.
Because some people are either jealous that you're doing what you're doing, or they're upset that they've never been able to. They wanted to, but couldn't. You know, we ran into the kid the other day at Alan's thing who said that he wanted to get a regular job.
Yes.
And he got a regular job at a bank. And
safe job.
A safe job, because he just wanted to work and then go home and do his thing. And I personally don't want to do that.
Everyone's different.
Right. It's your choice.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to look down on somebody who that's what they choose to
yeah.
do. But I'm not going to live my life that way. I'm not going to be like, I want a 9-to-5 so that I can come home and, you know, I can just pay the bill, you know, pay the bills doing that. That's not my I don't want to do that. Whatever. Whatever. I'm going home. I am home. Billy Stuckman. I've heard you say video editing programs are mostly the same. As long as you understand the concepts of editing, you can get the results you want. But how come most people seem to drift towards Premiere? I am very comfortable with Final Cut Pro X, and it works great for the wedding videography I do. Would love to see a video of what can be done with Premiere that can't be done in Final Cut Pro X. I mean, there's pros and cons to both.
There is.
What pros and cons have you seen, because you've used
Premiere? I haven't really used Final Cut. I've used it in college when it was 7, I think. But I haven't used it too much now. I use Premiere all the time. I went from 5.5 to 6 to CC. Advantages, they're about the same, I would say. I would say cons, at least from what I've experienced, from what Todd has told me, because he's a Final Cut user,
yeah.
is that Final Cut X seems to have a lot more presets available to you, where Premiere you have to do a lot more things manually. So if you don't know what you're doing, I personally don't think that's the best program to start out with. I think Final Cut would be a better program.
It also has the multicam editing.
But they both have multicam editing. They both do generally the same thing.
And Todd says he uses both. If he's cutting a feature film, he's cutting it in Premiere.
Yeah.
If he's just doing everyday stuff, it's like it doesn't matter. It's like they both pretty much, there's pros and cons to both.
I mean, I think there's a little more flexibility with Premiere, just from my experience. I can't be too confident on that because, again, I haven't used Final
right.
Cut. But, yeah, I mean, just if you're okay with Final Cut, stay with Final
right.
Cut.
There's, you're not missing out on
you're
anything
You're not missing
over
out
there.
On anything.
And what Todd has always said, and we do this in the Fronos Photo Guide to Video Editing, is we talked about it doesn't matter what you use. Every program's going to cut, move, this, that. It's going to have a timeline. The only things that change are the buttons. You know, some of the features are going to be slightly different, but the mentality and theories are all the same when it comes to
I will
to
say the one thing I do like about Premiere, because I am a big Adobe user, with using Adobe Audition for sound, with using the After Effects for motion and everything, using the dynamic link system between the Adobe programs is great, because you can literally right-click on like a sound clip in Premiere and open an Adobe Audition, save it, and it automatically saves back.
Well, you can round trip stuff too. And,
but you have to use Apple products.
Well, you would use the Apple stuff.
Yeah, you would use the Apple
stuff. You would use Final Cut.
Just me being more of an Adobe user, it's a lot more comfortable
you already
for
have
me to do that. Yeah.
Terry Peter, let's say you were hired without a contract to take photos at a concert. The person who hired you is a performer and also put on the show. I understand that they have the rights to use the images. No, they don't have the rights to use the images. You don't have a contract, so you don't understand that they have the rights to use the images that I take of them. But what about when they ask for photos of the other bands that you took? What do you do? I feel like they should only get the pictures of themselves and any involved with the band slash group. Am I wrong? Yeah, I think you're wrong. One, you didn't have a deal worked out with them. You know, it's one thing to have a contract. It's another thing to verbally and have emails. Like, I don't do a lot of contracts. I do a lot of this is what I'm going to do and this is what you're going to get. In this case, you if you didn't ask and it wasn't articulated, then you're both wrong, because nobody laid out what the ground rules were before.
You can't assume, yeah.
You can't assume that, oh, well, I'm only going to give them pictures of them. Look, they put on the show as the promoter, and they're the band. They want to use all the photos because they want to promote the show and promote the other bands. You need to... This all needs to be hammered out beforehand, and I know it's hard to do, but technically when you send an email to somebody, in my opinion, and you say, this is what I'm going to do and this is what you're going to get, you kind of lock each other into it because you have expectations of what the deliverables are. And this is why a lot of people are afraid to talk contracts and stuff beforehand, is because they're afraid that they're going to lose the job because they're either going to say they're too expensive or they're not giving enough away. You have to make that decision of what's going to happen. If you didn't, they're not entitled to the photos of even them because they gave you access. Now, it may be assumed, but nothing can be assumed. You need to put it down and find. That's like when people call and say, how much are you? Well, what do you need?
How much are you?
You know, how much are you? Well,
well
I've got that. Well, right. I'm more expensive for that. I get $10,000 to go to bed with me. It's like, it's, you know, gigolo thing. But that's the thing, is you have to lay out expectations. And a lot of people shy away when you start getting all businessy on them. But you're like, look, you're putting on a concert. You're going to get paid when people buy tickets. You have to take care of that. There's contracts to get with bands. There's contracts for merch. There's contracts for food and alcohol and venues. The same thing applies here. Here's my expectations. I will shoot the show for you. I will give you all the photos of yourself. If you want photos of everybody else, you're going to pay X.
Yep.
You just have to lay it out. You have to be blunt and just say it. Because if you wait till the end, this is what happens.
Yep.
In this case, just give them all the damn photos and just deal with it. You know? Because you're never going to shoot for the guy again if you make it too hard.
Yeah, start fresh next time.
But then you got to lay out the expectations. Say, you know what? Unfortunately, we didn't discuss this beforehand, so let's work something out together to make it work. But you got to be on fleek with this. Juan Jacino, if a photographer gets access to a show via a publication, newspaper, promoter, etc., is it okay to then share the images with another outlet, ethical or legal issues or both? When I shot for Rolling Stone, they had the rights to the images to run first. Once they ran the images,
then
I was free to do whatever I want. It is unethical, in my opinion, to go to an event and then try to give the images to a competitor, because these are the people that got you into the event. You ask. You have to know what the expectations are. Again, I knew that Rolling Stone said I could use the images after the fact, after they ran it. They don't own the rights. And they said this on the phone. They're like, we are basically getting one-time usage of that image. If we want to run it again, we pay you more money. That's usage is great.
Yeah.
Max Logan, when buying cameras online, what is the beat way? What is the best way to know you won't be scammed? The best way is freaking common sense. If it sounds too good to be true, it's too god darn good to be true.
Very true.
Go to the reputable places. You've got Allen's Camera's going to have official pricings. Your B&H's are going to... If B&H is listing a price it's legitimate.
Yep, and if someone's beating that B&H price by a ton of money, there's an issue. Not legitimate.
Common sense. If you think you're going to save money because it's like cheaper, it's cheaper for a reason.
Reputable it's places. Fake or something. Yeah.
Buy from reputable places. It's no secret. No secret. No
and
secret.
And keep in mind, they got a lot of those fake Nikon bodies going around too, especially on eBay and those kind of sites.
Which makes no sense.
Makes sense for the person selling it.
Colin Lack, what are the plans for the next 5-minute portraits? Are there any more Fro film project videos in the works? If so, would you consider using something strange like a Holga? And lastly, Raw Talk in Toronto. I need to get on Fleek with like Raw Talk around the country or world. I just need to set it up. It's just a lot of freaking work, and I got a lot of shit on my mind.
It's a lot of work, and we're doing a lot of work in the meantime setting up other things, so I feel like that's more on the back burner than some of the more important things like setting up the 5-minute portraits and stuff like that.
The 5-minute portraits, we do have more in the works, and yes, I do have things that I want to use, like the Holga and all of this different stuff. Natalie Skittles-Williams.
Skittles.
Will using a cheap brand of inks lower the quality of my prints? Yes. Again, I mean, I've dealt with this in the past. When you get shitty ink, it's shitty ink. Like, I remember back in the day that I used to get on eBay. It was called Ink in a Blink.
Yes.
And it would be inkjet ink for my Bubble Jet, HP Bubble Jet at the time.
Bubble Jet.
Like 460 BC. I don't even remember what they were called, but it was a photo printer. And you would get, and it was one cartridge for color. It had like the cyan, the magenta, and
the CMYK.
The CMY, well, no, black. Well, black was separate. Yeah. There were two cartridges. Yeah. One was CMY and then the K. Mm-hmm. And what I would realize is that it was almost like putting water on the page, just colored water. Like the ink quality wasn't even close. You could smell the difference in the ink as well. It was more watery. Same thing. It's like
water.
It's like I don't buy crappy, you know, for my brother printer. I can get off brand for half the price. I can get off brand toner. But I've encountered issues with leakage of the toner and toners just dying sooner. Just issues that mess with what you're doing. It's the same thing as buying from reputable places. There's a reason why they're certified official things.
Because they sell certified official things.
Because they are meant to work with that printer.
Yeah.
It's like you're going to do a disservice to your customers by buying shitty ink that looks bad. So absolutely do I think buying crappy ink. Would you buy false Skittles? Alexander James. Hi, guys.
Hey.
I'm 16 years old.
What's up, buddy?
And I have a haircut just like Steve Irwin's son.
Whoa.
He didn't say that. 16-year-olds and I have just been putting... Oh, okay. He sent me a message today. Alan James. Alexander James. Hi, guys. I'm 16 years old and I have just been put on the Instagram suggested list. If you're unsure what that is, ask Steven. He'll know. Or Google it. I mean, I know what it is. They put you on their recommended list. Should I focus on school and feel like I would waste my time with that and feel like I could out time and effort into photography? Damn it, kids. Proofread. I know I don't always proofread, but... Or should you pursue a career... No, you should say I. Or
this is how frustrated I get when I read your emails.
Should I pursue a career in photography now, which I sort of am doing, that e.g. working with clothing companies, etc., but trying to juggle school and do a good job of that and trying to produce high-quality work and develop my skills in photography is hard. If you were in my situation, what would you do and how would you do it? My Instagram is at Mr.AlexJames. Thank you.
Free promotion.
When you're 16, I mean, I guess college is a year or two away. What would I do? I mean, if you're getting traction now and you're working for other companies and you're shooting stuff, go with it. What I would say is get an education in business more so than get an education in photography, because that is what's going to help you more than going to photography school. You don't need photography school in this day and age. There are so many outlets that for some people, they want to go to a photography school like Antonelli and they want the 2 years of learning. But there's so many kids that come out of Antonelli. You're going to have 120 kids graduating. Well, it's about, 60 kids in each semester or 80, something like that. They're going to come out. How many of those kids are going to have actual paying jobs when they come out of school? When I was in school, and now, you know, from 2001, 2002, Richie was 2002. I was 2001 when I graduated. You know, you look at my class, I don't know, 6-7 people actually making a living as a photographer.
Yeah.
You know, out of 100 or 80 or something.
It's tough.
That's, you know... if you're already getting traction and you're already a photographer and you're already learning, just keep shooting and getting better. Talk to people, get, you know, go do things, go shoot, learn business. If you're going to go to college, then go for freaking business. But I would just go maybe take classes here and there. But I don't even like the classes that they offer, you know, because then they become just classes. You can learn from people.
Well, a lot of people, what I would say would be maybe to major in business if you go to a four-year school and minor in art or like photography or something like that. So you're still getting
video,
that underlining.
All of it.
Yeah, education. But at the same time, you're learning about
but
business.
But keep doing what you're doing. School, look, I don't care if you get, it's all about the piece of paper. At
it
the
is
end of
in the
day.
End, but you're also, you're learning too, obviously.
I'm not, what I was saying, it's all about the piece of paper. I'm saying I wouldn't always worry so much about the grades.
Yes. Right.
You want to learn.
As long as you're passing.
As long as you're passing. What you have to remember with college is you get out of it what you put into it.
Yep.
They're not there to hold your hand like elementary school and tell mommy and daddy that, you know, Johnny didn't do his homework or he's not performing well. It's your job to get everything out of the teachers that you can. Mm-hmm. You are paying their salary. You are paying to go to school. I became a pain in the ass. I was a pain in the ass, but I also found the right teachers that were willing to go the extra mile. I had one teacher, Ed Marco, who was a 4x5 teacher, very quiet guy. And, you know, he cared for the people that actually gave a shit.
Yeah.
The ones that didn't care, he didn't care. He's like, I'll fail them. They'll fail. Unless, if they're going to ask for help and they actually want it, I'll spend all the time they need. And I would spend extra time with him after class just talking, just learning, just asking questions and getting answers and getting help. And I do that with all of the all the teachers that I had that I wanted to talk to, because it's just a matter of, you know, you got to use everything. And that's why it's difficult to go to school as an 18-year-old.
It is.
Because you don't know this. You're still in school mode. That's why every other country in the freaking world allows kids to go on vacation for a year or 18 months or 6 months before they decide where they want to go to school.
Well, you still have the freedom to not go to school for a
year. Of course you do, but
yeah.
It's not the same here as in like Germany or Europe when they say, go discover the world. Like that is their thing, is they go out for 3 months or they go work here for 3 months and then go wherever they want to go and explore and backpack through Europe. You know, that's like you're discovering what you want to do, because at 18, you don't know what you want to do and you go right into school. That's why going back to school to learn is so much more effective than just coming out of high school and going. But it's also a lot different than if you're just living at home doing nothing. There's a difference.
It took me till I was 20 until I finally decided on an actual major of what I wanted to do. At first, I was undeclared for, I think, the first 2 years, just doing your gen eds and getting them out of the way.
It's a good show, right? Undeclared?
Undeclared? Is that a show?
It was a show.
Oh, I don't know.
I think it was a Seth Rogen thing.
Is
James
it?
Franco.
I like them.
I think it was Undeclared.
Undeclared?
Isn't that the one where they were... No, that was Freaks and Geeks.
Freaks and Geeks, you're thinking
but
of.
But then
one
they
season.
Did one season of a college show that they did.
Oh, was it supposed to be the follow-up to Freaks and Geeks?
No, I think it was called
like
Undeclared.
A spin-off?
I think it was called Undeclared.
But was it part of Freaks and Geeks? Or
no, it was just
completely
a new series.
Okay.
Now,
never heard of it.
It was funny as hell. Watch the full season.
Wonder if it's on Netflix.
Oh my God, I hope it is. What?
I forget the kid's name. I hope. So Instagram suggested users.
Alexander James, hi.
Okay. You only get 2 weeks as a suggested user. So really, really, really take advantage. You're already going to miss a week before you hear this, but I would focus this whole 2 weeks on putting up really great content and then, you know, go
and
back
and then
to
you
your
pick the
life.
Oh, that's a good suggestion. Good job. Pat yourself on the back. That's true. I didn't know that.
Were you a suggested user then, I guess?
I was not, no.
Oh,
but
okay.
I have a couple of friends that have been.
I don't think I ever was.
Here,
no,
I know
if you get it, if
you know it,
they direct message you, and you'll probably get 20,000 followers.
Wow,
in
I wonder
like
how do they choose?
They just choose,
random.
DM you, and then they just say, "Hey, you're a suggested user."
So here's the thing, people.
I assume he was talking about you then when he said Steven knows.
Yes,
what, okay, because I was like, I don't know.
Yeah, no.
I assume it was me. I don't
here's
know.
The thing. What Sutter just said is. If you're big on Instagram and you're doing a lot of stuff, I looked at some of his stuff and it's quality things that you're putting out. That's what it comes down to. If this is what you want to do, you focus there. There's nothing wrong with being that Instagram photographer and turning it into business. There's nothing wrong with it. I may bitch about, you know, get upset when somebody's not a quote unquote traditional photographer and they've got 400,000 subscribers and they're getting paid to fly around the world and I still think the photos suck, that doesn't matter because people are following it and they have a reach.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's just the nature of the beast. Focus, but don't get stuck. You know, if it's only a 2-week thing, don't put your whole future on the backs of that. But if you're getting gigs from people, then obviously keep doing that. Learn business. What I just said, I'm not going to repeat. I probably would.
You probably would.
Joe LaForge. What are your thoughts on the NDP government becoming a majority in Alberta last night? Canadian politics is important too, right? A, yes. Go NDP government. No, don't like the NDP government. A, I don't like them. They're flappy heads. No, no good. Oh, no, buddy. You're not my pal.
Flappy heads.
You're right.
Oh, man.
Go Canadian politics.
Where did that question come from?
That's well, so because random. I talk about politics so on occasion. So yeah. He does, because I don't talk about Canadian politics because I know nothing about it.
He said Alberta,
knew
right?
Nothing of that.
Yeah, Alberta.
I'll be in Alberta in August, so maybe I'll say hi.
There you go.
Sean K. Regan, Jared, did you apparently, when my grandfather gives me the remote control, all he ever wants to watch is the Powerball.
Apparently.
I just wanted to say the apparently kid again.
I thought he wrote that. I was like,
no.
He wrote that?
Did you? No, it's because I was like, did you?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you / did you ever get bogged down by the fear of tomorrow? The fear of never making it to where you want to be in life.
Ooh.
For example, every morning I wake up, I wonder, why am I not living my dream of being a music photographer? I just wonder if you ever felt / feel the same way. Thanks. Well, if you wake up every freaking morning saying the same freaking thing, then maybe you need to do something about it. But living your dream as a music photographer
is the
difficult.
Most realistic dream.
It may not be realistic.
Not to put him down or
not
anything.
No, not to put you down, but to say it truly like it is.
Yeah.
Not many people are making a living out there in the world of music photography. If that's what you want to do, do it, but take the steps to make it happen. The hardest thing to do is to put yourself out there to make it happen, and you have a fear of failure, but you got to get past the fear of failure. And Steven will tell you that I wake up every morning and...
sending my heartbeat.
And I haven't sent him my heartbeat yet.
Yeah, you have.
Not after sleeping with anybody like you do.
I don't know what you're talking about. I was running that night.
I'm like, why is his heart beating so fast?
Well, and then I think I wrote you a little message after that.
What did it say?
I don't know.
Did it say S-E-X?
No.
It
said running.
There's not enough room on there to write running. You know, every morning I wake up, I wonder why I'm not living my dream. Well, I mean, if you've discovered what it is you want to do, then you need to take the steps to make it happen.
Yeah.
Did you ever get bogged down by the fear? Yeah, I get bogged down all the time. The email I sent Steven this morning is the bogged down in my freaking brain. There's things I want to accomplish that I'm not doing because I'm getting held back by, well, what if I don't make a video today? What if I don't do this? What about this? You know, what's Steven going to do? How am I going to make a Raw Talk if I just leave and go travel and shoot photos doing what I really want to do sometimes? But I just have to do it and just be like, Steven, you're just going to get paid to sit at home and do something. You know, it's just, or you're going with me, you know?
I usually go with you, I feel
like. Right, but a lot of it, see, the hard part with what I do, and this goes through my brain every single day, is how do I steer the ship? How do I make sure that enough video guides, you know, people are seeing them to then go ahead and purchase them to keep everything growing so that you can keep sustaining what you're doing.
The thing with you, I think, is that you really do need a dedicated assistant to handle all that backlog, the back end stuff, and so you can focus on more of the videos that you're doing now, I feel like.
But what would an assistant do?
See, I feel like, but then you also want the control, so you wouldn't even want them to be in charge of that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
It's tough. You
I don't want people
so
making decisions
things.
For
it's,
me.
It's mind-boggling how much stuff you deal with.
People can't make decisions. I don't, you know, anytime you let people, I don't like when people make decisions. They can't make decisions for me. I just, if I
well,
say
you're a very particular person,
very
too.
Particular.
There's nothing wrong with that.
But there's a reason why decisions get made. Everything that I do whether it's good or bad, or most of the things I do, is calculated for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, there's a reason why I only post the image on Instagram versus posting it on Facebook and Twitter. You know, there's certain aspects of why this, it's calculated. You have to spread things out a certain way. But then maybe you don't. Maybe you just need to do whatever the hell you want and it works. But that's what I've done all along, is I've done what I've wanted and I felt that it would be calculated and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Chris Fleckfro. I'm trying to increase my client base and seem to be hitting a wall. I'm marketing with Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and my webpage. Thanks for the Squarespace discount. Shit. Discount. That was a slip of the tongue. I'm also trying to get my wife to do some verbal marketing. Is that also called oral marketing? When she is at various events. Any suggestions for reeling the clients in and just increasing page views? Wait. And not just increasing page views. Look, I mean, maybe you're going about this all wrong, thinking it's all about marketing. If you just be real, I'm not saying you're not. I don't know your situation. I'm just saying, put out quality work. Give people a reason to interact. Don't always be selling. Because it sounds like from the marketing, I could be wrong, but from what it's saying that I'm marketing here. Well, people get tired of hearing about marketing. They get tired of hearing, I'm going to give a discount photo, you know, discount on this sale, and there's this sale, and, you know, I've got bookings. I need to do bookings and stuff like that. It gets old. Interact and have discussions and share and ask questions. Don't push. The jab, then the right hook. The give, then the ask. You know, Gary can just write the same book 12 times by just changing the give, yeah. Ask, jab, right hook,
yep.
skate, pass, shoot, you know, pass, shoot.
Score, yeah.
You know, run, jump.
You literally can write the same thing over and over.
What else could we do?
hit, home run.
Right. Single, grand slam.
There you go.
No, single, you know, one bag at a time, then grand slam.
Yeah.
Basically, in essence, the same thing.
Yeah.
Crawl, walk. crawl, run.
This could be the entire show of just that.
I think he's found something.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, so I answered that question. Trace Van Gordon. Hey, Fro, I started a digital photography school in Charlotte, North Carolina, called the Aperture Lab. We are starting to fill classes and everything is going good. 2 days ago, the owner of another established photography school in Charlotte, the one I attended for about a year, he also took my class.
Oh.
Trace, when we were in somewhere. Year calls me and tells me he is basically upset. I am upset that one of his previous students has opened a rival school a mere 7 miles from his. He also read me the Riot Act about using the information of his class in my classes. Thoughts? Well, if you are using the information from his classes, then that's bad. Opening a rival anything against somebody else, it's called competition.
Yep.
Deal with it. If people are going to go learn from Trace and his school, then they're going to go learn from his school. Does he have the experience? He took my class. Am I upset that he's going to take that information and parlay that into his own? No. Because he's going to hopefully turn that into his own information.
Well, yeah.
It's like, I went to high school.
If you're like plagiarizing his direct, exact, whatever documentation he had during his class,
right.
That's a different story.
But you're not reinventing the wheel here. You're teaching photography. I've been to classes. I've gone to school. I've listened to what teachers have to say. There is no secret in the exposure triangle. You teach in your own way. You change the terminology, but you're not doing anything that is patentable.
Everyone's essentially copying each other from the first person who took a picture.
Right,
you know,
and
I
don't know if this is an actual real school called the Aperture Lab, or it's just a place that does classes. Maybe things are different in North Carolina. I don't know accreditation versus not accreditation. Mm. Makes sense, yo?
Yeah.
Yeah, yo.
More pages of this stuff. All right, a couple more questions. Carrick Sullivan. When traveling, if you hand your camera to someone to take your picture, do you prefer taking test shots first to get your settings and stay in manual, or throw the camera in auto and hope for the best? This is what I do.
Good question.
I make sure my exposure is right.
I do too.
I flip the autofocus mode to auto focus, where it's gonna
all the focus
where
points.
It's gonna use all the focus points, and recommendation, turn it off of 11 frames a second, because I guarantee you they'll take 7.
Yep.
So that's what I do. Let them take pictures. The focus finds the right place. The exposure's right. Just get the picture, check it, and make sure it's good. That's the thing.
I'll even actually will adjust the focal length, too, to get the frame right and then tell them. Yeah, I'll go that far.
What a dick. Kat Wickstrom. Hello,
douche.
Fro. I've done a wedding expo, but the turnout was horrendous. How do you vet an expo? Do you recommend attending them before buying a table? That is a great question.
Yeah.
This is one of those things where you have to make sure it's a reputable expo. There's a lot of expos out there, and if they don't market well to get brides, if they aren't established, they haven't been around for 20 years or 15 or 10 years doing this, absolutely go attend some of them. You know, you can sign up for free, I think, to attend these things, see what they go, and then you could also take a look at what other photographers are doing. But, you know, you could ask people what expos they... do your research. See how many people attended. Because that's one of the metrics that you can ask for, is how many people attended, how many brides, and the good, reputable ones will say, last year's was attended by 156 brides, or 253. And when there's brides, there's also family members. So that is a good question. You just have to vet them, because... if the turnout is horrendous, then you just wasted time.
It might also not be bad for a beginning wedding photographer to join an expo like that one and do a practice run.
No, that's a waste of money.
Is it a waste of money?
Absolutely. Okay. Go do the best of the best of the best.
How much do they charge?
I don't know. I was paying like $600 for the day.
Oh, I didn't know it was that expensive.
Which isn't, well, they could be paying $300. I wouldn't want to pay $300. I'd rather pay $600. This is how I got my big wedding jobs. Most of them, other than word of mouth, was the thought. How will I be seen by more? How will I get me in front of more wedding potential clients?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, let's go to expos.
Boom.
$600? Shit, that's a lot of money.
Yeah, I would not have.
But $600
is expensive.
One deposit. Yeah. All you need to do is book one to break, you know, to
break
at least,
even, yeah.
I mean, more than break even, because I'm not going to charge $600 for the wedding. It's going to be at least $3,000 or $3,500. So all I need to do is do one. And if I do none, so be it. I do none. It's just a draw. And when I was doing them, it was 2007 and 2008.
So they probably charge.
No, they were charging the same, but that was during a downturn. That was during a recession. That was during the major correction that we were having, and people weren't spending money.
And you still got clients.
I still got a few, but then the year after, it died down a little bit doing the same show because people were in dire straits. They were losing their homes. They weren't getting, like, maybe they weren't getting married, or maybe they weren't spending the money.
Holding off the wedding. Yeah.
Richard Ritter. Hey, guys, a question for all of you. I teach high school photography and require students to take darkroom photography prior to taking my digital class. The question is always asked, why do we have to learn to shoot film first? How would you personally answer this? Thanks in advance. I'd say because you need to.
I'm
the teacher. I dictate to you what gets the, you're the student. Because you have to. And the simple answer is, you're going to thank me. You won't thank me now. You'll thank me later. You're too young to understand, but you will get it one day. Because if you figure out how hard it is to do it this way, you're not going to be such a dick twerp when you start shooting other photos digitally. You're going to be prepared. What?
I think one of the biggest things...
I'm not being a dick. I'm sorry.
When I did black and white photography and darkroom and everything, I think one of the biggest advantages for me was... learning the terminology and how it transfers over to, say, like Lightroom, for example, to processing on a computer, like dodging, burning, all that terminology I learned in the darkroom, and I understood what it meant when I started doing digital photography. That was what really helped me out, and just the actual process of processing film.
Good for you.
Yeah.
No,
that was
right.
Me personally.
Oh, I mean, I didn't have a choice.
That's what came out of it for me.
But I bitched and moaned about the 4x5 and said, why do I need to learn the 4x5 when we don't do this?
See, I never did 4x5, though.
And they're like,
I did strictly 35mm.
They didn't really have an answer. But things that you learn in 4x5, you can parlay into everything else. It's all education. It's all learning. It's all better. As a high school teacher, I would tell the kid, I'd be like, kid, slap him in the face. Be like, just because I'm the teacher, I'm the authority figure, and this isn't a democracy.
It's just good to have an understanding, too, of how it started.
It's just like, if you get it there, then it's going to make my next class that much more enjoyable.
It transfers over so much. It's just so much easier to learn digital photography when you start there.
Jeremy Brewer. Hey, Fro, I love the show. I have a 12-year-old son that asks if he could borrow my new camera. I am just getting back into the hobby after about 15 years. I let him use it, just setting it to auto, and told him to go crazy. That's nice, by the way. I always say that. give the kid the camera, take, put it on auto.
Go nuts.
The fact, and just shoot.
Yeah.
When I uploaded the card, I was stunned at some of the pictures. He now wants a real quote-unquote camera for his birthday, and I'm thinking about a D3000. Mine is a D3300. First of all, would that be a good starter DSLR for him? They look pretty affordable on eBay. He's also interested in video. I know what my 3300 will do, but I have no clue what he can get out of a D3000. I'm also sending him to your website for some of your tips, hopefully with earmuffs. I just said that. But I think a lot of your stuff, while I love it, is a little technical for a kid. No, it's not. It's not technical for a kid. Go out and shoot pictures. Just turn your dial to this and go shoot a pic. Too technical. I'm Mr. Freaking Rogers. With more cursing. Do you have any pointers on the best way to get him going?
How old is he again?
12.
12, okay.
That's, just a few years younger than
Summer. Too young.
No, that's not too young to understand what I'm saying. Sit down with my video guide and you'll understand it. God, I feel offended now. So the D3000, I was thinking at first that I was going to say, well, he wants to get into video. I would focus on shooting photos first. Tell him the video will come in the future. That by learning the stills now, it's going to make you a better videographer in the future because the same rules apply. Understanding the exposure triangle, it's a definitely great starting point. The D3000 is a piece of crap. I have one. It's a good learning tool. I'm sure the 3100 is cheap, and I'm sure a 3200 is cheap. Or you could go the other way and give him the D3300 and buy yourself a nicer camera. But look, if a D3000 is really... a D3000 is only going to do stills. It's going to be limited with the ISO. He may, you know, get him that with a 35-1.8 or even the 18-55 kit lens. Tell him to just go shoot and start with that and then get my beginner guide or ask me for a beginner guide and let him start to understand that after a couple of weeks or months of shooting. Sit down with him, look at the photos, critique them, and then just talk about pointers. Here, look at this for composition. Look at this for composition. Do you see why that this image is too dark and the sun was in the background? Here's how we could start to make those corrections. Let's go out and shoot together and learn. Start with whatever you can start with, but just be positive with it. And then when it gets to a certain point where he's limited by that 3000 or he's learning enough, then you could start moving into video.
Yep.
But I would start with the photos first. I thought I was going to be like, yeah, video is good. Get a camera that does both. But actually, it may be better just to do a D3000 to force him to just do photos.
Mm-hmm.
It's flying solo.
Boom.
Bang.
It's done.
Done.
Sutter.
Yes, sir.
Don't hold up this big ass box. Hey, come here and hold up this big ass box.
That is a big ass box.
What's in the box, Sutter?
What's in the box?
What are you taking notes on? I'm just writing through the week down. Oh, is there enough time on the clocks? 8 minutes. All right, yeah, hold up this big box. Can you grab the other box, Eckert? So, as you know, a couple weeks ago, I talked about Epson. Here is the Epson Sure Color SCP-600. What really upsets me about it is that the box doesn't actually show you what the printer is inside. They used to have a nice print on the outside to show you what was in it. Is it heavy? Is it your brother? All right, you can put it down. But that's the box that it comes in. I opened it thinking that there would be the box that had the other stuff. You don't take it out. Don't take it out. I thought that it would have other... I thought it was a box that was the shipping box.
Yeah.
And then inside it would be... would be the label box, but that's just the nature of it. So I asked for the P, whatever that's called, the SCP-600. That's a 13-inch wide printer. I don't know how many inks it takes, but they showed it to us in October at the booth at Photo Plus.
Photo Plus, yeah.
And the colors were absolutely tremendous coming off of it. So we've been trying since October to get the printer. Short story, long story short, the printer is officially here. We're going to run it through its paces. They also gave me paper. What I like is that you've got something like this. This is 10 meters? It's 10 meters. Over 32 feet of paper in this roll.
Wow.
I don't know. I have a call.
Are you going to do the ruler?
I'm going to print a ruler. Yeah, 10-meter ruler. Actually, what I should go do is like shoot a football field and print it out.
Oh, 100 that would be
meters.
Good. Yeah.
That'd be like, sorry, they, 100 they, yards.
Do they have a, yeah, they probably have a big enough roll, right?
Well, I don't know. This roll is 10, it's 32 feet. So, oh, is that 32 inches long? I don't know. What the hell is that?
32 feet.
It, 10 meters is like 10 meters.
A meter is like 3.1 feet or something.
I don't. It's made in Japan, all
right? So that's like 30-something feet right there.
Yeah, 30-something feet.
So you would
here.
Need a bigger roll, but I don't know if that printer will support a bigger roll.
You'd need a lot of these.
Yeah.
All right, next. I like that it has a roll. I don't know that it has a cutter on it. So does it cut your paper at the end if you're on a roll? I have a call with them because I want to know the high-level information so I can be edumacated on it. But they gave this also has a roll of canvas.
Ooh.
So it's glossy canvas so you can print out like...
I forgot. That's, yeah, they showcased that at
Photo Plus. That was the cool
that
thing
really
if you want
cool.
to print it home. And yeah. then we've got ultra-premium photo paper luster. This is the velvet fine art paper. It says velvet fine art. This 100% cotton fiber paper features an acid-free base with an elephant. No. An elegant velvet surface that delivers a high D-max and a wide color gamut. Well, shit, that sounds like something I'd love to see. Nice D-max. So that's one piece of paper. We got Hot Press Bright. Really? Hot Press Bright.
Hot off the press?
Designed with an extremely smooth, bright white surface.
Ooh.
Sounds like my... this 100% cotton fiber, acid-free, light-free... No, lignin.
Lignin.
You mean linen?
Lignin.
Linen.
Lignin-free paper delivered a high D-max, beautiful tonal transitions, and a wide color gamut. Metal gamut? Photo glossy paper and metallic photo glossy paper, metallic photo paper luster.
I feel like you're going to like that a lot.
I'm not going to like the metallic paper.
No?
No, it's a gimmick. I'm going to stick with the good photo. We're going to try this stuff out. What we'll do is we'll print the same image out. On all different papers, yeah. So people can see how it works. Yep. That's all I have to say about that. Finally, we got it. I just can't wait to use it.
Yeah.
All right, Sutter, what do you need to do? Wheel of Fro?
Yeah.
You want to reset the cameras, then do Wheel of Fro?
That works.
All right, so now it's time for the Wheel of Fro coming up. What were you just telling me?
I was saying for checking time, we should just do a stopwatch on our watch.
I didn't think about that.
I didn't think about that, too, until I accidentally hit it on my watch because it's on my...
it's on your front thing?
Screen, whatever you call it.
Well, currently we're in Philadelphia. It's sunny. It's 79 sunny with a high of 81 and a low of 59.
Ooh.
The sun goes down today at 7:59. And my dad, I tell that to my dad, and he goes, thank you, Wally Canaan. Wally Canaan was a weatherman.
Was he?
Wally Canaan, the
local?
Weatherman. Yeah, in Philly before I was born.
Hmm.
So here we go with the Wheel of Fro. We've got Rode microphones. We use those Rodes, and Steven does that each and every week.
and you do this each and every week.
Well, I have to read the stuff.
And I have to do this. What are you doing, Sutter?
Oh, Sutter, that is unbelievable because you're not used to that girth. So, oh, hey.
Hey.
Oh, hey. Hi, Maria.
Are you sending your heartbeats to each other?
No, nobody else has the phone, like a watch that I know of.
We only send it to each other.
We only send heartbeats to each other. I send things back like, dick.
I wish they had more emojis.
The emojis
know?
Are stupid.
They only have like four.
They're horrible.
Yeah.
That's why I like drawing on it.
Yeah, I like drawing
too. At first, I didn't know how to send it. I'm like, how does it send?
And it just automatically
sends. It automatically disappears.
Me too. I was like, did
I send
it
already? I'm like tapping. Yeah. I'm like, where's the send button?
Well, I think the haptic touch, it's a little weird because you just like, do little touches and then I guess it taps the same thing.
You'll
on
feel
your,
it. Yeah.
Is that what it is?
Yeah.
I never really did that with you. I gotta do that.
Yeah, I want to feel the touch.
That yet.
I want to hear the taptic touch. I'm gonna wrap it around my penis. Steven, can you play your heartbeat? Oh my god, I bet
too
you
far.
Somebody's done that.
Too far.
Well, it can be right next to the slap
Wait, you
bracelet.
Can feel each other's heartbeat? Or like is that
yeah,
what it does?
Yeah, it's his actual touch. Heartbeat. So his heart was racing the other night for whatever reason. All right, Rode microphone. Thank you. They're on the wheel. Question mark means you get anything on the wheel but the main prize. Borrow lenses is $250 in borrow lenses credit. Fro prize means you get to sit on my face. You get some Fro prize. Plastic printers, $250 in free. $250 free business cards. Videoblocks.com/go/fro. That's where we get a lot of our B-rolls and video blocks that we need.
Video stuff.
Stuff. Squarespace. You can go to squarespace.com/fro. I use it. Squarespace 7 is awesome. It's real easy to set up your freaking website. You get your 14-day free trial. You should go try it because I think once you use it, you're going to like it. You can abuse it because you can use it. You abuse it, you lose it if you don't abuse it. Something like that.
Is that how it goes?
But look, the moral of the story with Squarespace is if you need a website for your photography stuff, in less than an hour, you will be up and running with a full-fledged website. I wish you could find an hour to do that.
Dude, it's more going back in my catalog
and picking all
the pictures.
Black Rapid, you'll get a Black Rapid strap. Rode microphones on there again. Then we've got the Atomos Ninja 2.
Yes.
if it lands on that, you are winning that. And it's not the bare bones one.
The full kit.
It's the full kit.
Yeah.
Full bones.
$695 value.
You will get the full bone.
Ooh.
Adorama picks. Don't forget about that code, PXFRO35MD, to get 35% off your photo books until May 16th. Take advantage of 35% off, because that's like more than 20% off. It's more than 25%. It's more than 34%. It's 35% off.
It's a lot of percent.
Fro prize, think tank photo bag, audioblocks.com/fro/go/fro. All the extra audio we've been doing here, that's where it comes from. Mm-hmm. Squarespace again, Lightroom for the Adobe crowd, creative crowd, crowd.
Sarah.
I'm going to spin it, and then we're going to tell you who it's for.
Spin it to win it.
I made a note.
I think I saw you star someone's name,
I starred
right?
somebody's name. That's
Ooh.
How I remember these
that's
things.
What I figured.
Because if I don't do that while we're doing it, I will fail. At remembering who did, I'll be like, Steven, just pick somebody because I can't do it anymore. What time is it, Eckert? I mean, Sutter?
Whoa, we don't even look the same.
He has a mustache.
Yeah, you're both called Stephanie.
Oh, God.
Stephanie. Go.
We're off
Yeah, I wanted to. The power compelled me to spin it really hard.
I feel the wind.
Around and around it goes. Where it stops, nobody knows. The wheel of Fro is about to stop on something. Around and round. Oh.
Nah,
oh,
it's not gonna hit it.
Oh. Think tank!
Oh my God!
Congratulations to Kat Wickstrom. You won yourself a bag from
Ooh.
Think Tank.
What was the question for
her? Her question was, hello, Fro. I've done Wedding Expo, but the turnout was horrendous. How do you vet an expo? Blow? Joe? And that's that. That's the Wheel of Fro. Thank you to everybody that's on the Wheel of Fro. Congratulations to Kat, who asked the question and got to spin the wheel. And we have reached the end of 132. You can get all the photo news and more at froknowsphoto.com/rawtalk-132. It's absolutely on Fleek this week.
Oh, it is.
That's the name of the show, is On Fleek.
There you go. Boom.
We actually have a title before the end of the show. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you guys out there for watching. And this week was sponsored by Atomos. So thank you, Atomos. Mm-hmm. Check out all of the Atomos stuff. We use the Atomos stuff. And if you want to be bare bones with Atomos, that will be out in June. If you want to get the A7S and get a 4K recorder with that, you better take advantage of it because they're giving you $500 back. That's like saying, here's free $500. Go do something with it.
Pretty much.
Why don't we give you $500? I want $500 because then I could do something with it. Like, I'll sleep with it. Like, hey, $500, what are you doing?
Here's my heartbeat.
Yeah. Well, for $500, you could buy a watch and send somebody your heartbeat.
There you go.
You have to buy two watches.
Well, you would buy them a watch, considering that you already had a watch. That's what I'm saying.
Gotcha.
Where's your black band?
I'm still waiting for it, man.
Did it even go through?
I ordered it. It gave me the confirmation saying that it'll send me another email when it gets shipped.
Oh, they must be out of stock.
So it's been at least a week. Yeah, well, I ordered it the night of. I thought it'd be by my house within like 2-3 days.
You should complain.
Real men have white bands.
Actually, my grandma used to wear shit like that.
A nice velvet, like,
no, the clippy
bracelet.
Things, like the old women,
the jewelry.
Always, they would have like seven of them, and then the round one that goes through your arm and stuff. So that's that. Check out the Atomos stuff. Check out my stuff. Take advantage of the strap-on deal.
Ooh.
It's no code needed. It's just $15 lower than where it normally starts at $64.99 to get that strap. PXFRO 35MD. And I'm done.
That's it.
Thank you guys for watching. Jared Polin, FroKnowsPhoto.com. See you.